Boot Screen Podcast. Real talk.
What up, y'all? It's your boy Boot Screen. We back again. You know how we do. We always got somebody that's special, somebody that's close to me, you know, and somebody that's in the game. But let's give a huge round of applause to my brother from another mother, Thomas Pritchin, y'all.
What's up, bro?
What up, man? Good?
Shit, chill. Yeah, I'm good.
Mm-hmm. I know. Listen, God is good, bro. hey, man. Well, no, let's get right into it, man. So, I guess for people who don't really know you, you know what I'm saying? Like if you can give them a small little background where you come from and, you know, all that you've done and all that you do.
Well, I am from California,
mm-hmm.
and I grew up playing in church, and
yep, just like me.
I've been playing since, I guess, a really young age.
Okay.
And I guess, you know, I grew up with a lot of musicians that are, like, you know, been super influential,
mm-hmm.
Over the time, you know, as far as, like, Gospel Chops and, like, the whole R&B and gospel circuit.
Right.
And then I just been around playing, doing my thing, playing all styles of music and trying to inspire people as much as possible. And
you definitely inspire,
you know, my thing.
You inspire,
you know what I mean?
Believe that, bro. That's real. Like, I ain't even saying that because, you know, we brothers and we on here. This is like, this is real talk. I remember Man introduced me to you, and shout out to Man, of course, but I remember he introduced me to you, and it was just like, yo, I ain't never hear nobody approach the way you approach, because especially on the West Coast, you know what I'm saying? So it was dope to hear somebody on a whole different coast play with that rawness, you know what I'm saying? So, like, I promise you, brother, you guarantee, you listen, you're inspiring, mm-hmm. niggas. Don't believe that, bro.
Thank you.
But, so tell me, like, as far as, like, the you know, the whole playing in church, of course, a lot of us came from that. What made you want to really get into, like, jazz and, like, fusion and to rock and, like, you know, hip-hop and all that?
Well, when I grew up in church, it was like my grandmother, we used to have a thing where if we didn't go to church, we couldn't really do nothing. So we go to church all the time. And then I was in, like, a gospel choir that used to travel around. Mm-hmm. We used to go to, like, GMWA.
Right.
And I just remember just meeting a lot of different drummers from all over the coast. So I was all over, not just the coast, but all over the country is what I meant. And so I would meet people in the East Coast and, you know, other drummers in California, since California's so big. And then we just kind of, like, all connected.
Right.
Super young age, you know, not just drummers, you know, keyboard players and bass players also, but we would just give each other, like, you know, people to learn from, our videos, our music, CDs, and VHSs.
Right.
And, you know, as the quest for learning, you just, you know, have no choice but to dive outside of people who played a similar style of you. So
mm-hmm.
we would go check out, like, Dennis Chambers and Dave Weckl and Vinny Caliuta.
Yeah,
we were just checking out people who weren't necessarily inspired by church, you know, or maybe they didn't go to church. Maybe they were, like, fusion drummers.
Yeah.
And we would take those skills to church. And
that's
then
crazy. Yep, that's the truth, yo.
Yep. And then after out of nowhere, it was like I just was trying to get into so many different styles. My grandmother would put me in, you know, school for music, and they would play, like, jazz or classical, and then I would take lessons from drummers that weren't from the same circuit. So
okay.
my I guess I was getting so many different genres of music so fast,
mm-hmm.
that I had no choice but to, like, want to learn,
yeah.
you know, these different styles from other people. So it made me gravitate towards, you know, even rock. Like, rock, I learned a lot of the rock stuff just because I was skateboarding. Like, I was skateboarding at 13.
I never knew that,
where
bro.
I live.
That's decent.
So, like, all the people who, you know, people who skateboard, you know, they was listening to Suicidal Tendencies, and they was listening to Living Color or NOFX.
Yeah.
And all the punk bands. So I would go to church, and I would be listening to, like, John P. Key and, like, Donald Lawrence and Hezekiah Walker, all the mm-hmm. big records at the time.
Right.
And then I would also get my rock school by, you know, after school skateboarding when I was in middle school, or mm-hmm. like, you know, being in a jazz band. Those guys would be like, you need to learn about Jeff Payne Watts or Elvis.
Right.
I was learning about, like, Liddell and, like, Coon and
mm-hmm.
like I can't even think of everybody. What's the name? Played on the Donald Lawrence records. I can't forget. It's too many people, man.
I'm about to say it's a lot. It's not a catch, yo.
I can't think. Why is his name?
Come on, yeah, help him, so, help him, Lord.
Charles Haynes. No, it's not Charles.
Fishing for names. There's so many people, bro.
Smoking weed, bro. I swear to God. But yeah, I can't think of everybody's names. But I was so in, you know, listening to Joel Smith also, and then, you know, when in GMWA you would hear, you know, musicians that weren't necessarily on all the major records. So I got to learn about like Aaron Spears, and then, you know, Eric Trivett would come through.
OG.
And play. That's from Philly. I know you know him. And then, you know, and then I was highly influenced by Jamie Gamble.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Jamie Gamble was like, you know, from LA, and he used to come and he just had like a super, just super, so much flavor, you know what I mean? And then, you know, all of us was also like hella fucking influenced by Mint Condition.
Of course. So, Chris Dave.
Used to love Stokely and right. Chris. Yeah. So. So I was just soaking up all the game from all the people who was just like in my circuit, but I also was trying to soak up game from people that necessarily wasn't.
Yeah, yeah.
And I had a drum teacher here. His name was Alfredo Reyes Senior, and he was like I think he's now in his 80s, but he's from Cuba, and so he would have like Giovanni come to his house and Horacio would come to his house, and he lived like 20 minutes 30 minutes away from me, so I was getting to learn about the Latin world, the rock world from skating, the church world, because my grandmother made me go to church all the time. And then I was, you know, watching like Dennis Chambers.
yeah that's crazy, yo. That's a lot of damn, that's crazy. So like, yo, like, you understand, bro, like, to know you is one thing, you know what I'm saying, like to know of you and to know you like That's one thing, but to know your history, like where you really acquired your music and your lessons and your teachings and like the inspirations, bro. Like, I ain't gonna hold you. Like, this is dope, man. Like, this is why I love doing this. I get to find out shit I never knew. Real talk.
Yeah, man.
You know what I mean? So with, all right, understanding that you basically acquired a lot of this music. Some of you may know, some of you may not know, but you got a Grammy. Right?
Yeah.
God is great, because everybody won Grammys. We all won Grammys and a white picket fence. But like, tell me, bro, how did that really feel, getting that Grammy? And who'd you get that Grammy with, just in case they don't know?
I got the Grammy with I ended up winning a Grammy with the Mars Volta. We won Best Rock Performance for a song named Wax that I played on the Bedlam record.
Okay.
But I went to the Grammys before, and we were nominated, not as the Mars Volta, but I was nominated with Christian Scott for Rewind That. Before I ever got into Mars Volta. And so, like, when that happened with Rewind That, to me, like, I mean, when we first made that record, we made a record before that wasn't released on a major label, but it had a similar vibe,
right.
A couple of the same songs, and that was a record we released when we was at Berklee School of Music, and so people around Berklee was just like, we was killing it at Berklee, like, you know, just doing gigs, and then after he left, you know, after we left, we just started taking it on the road, and he got a deal, and so. After we did Rewind That, we got nominated for something at the Grammys, and I felt like we should have won it, just because it's like, at that time I didn't really like, it was a few records that was like jazz records that were playing a backbeat, but you know, it was like, you know, some, you know, like Yellow Jacket was a little bit, you know, before us, but like kind of like enough before us that people weren't doing what they were doing
exactly,
and then RH Factor was doing their thing. But I don't know. I kind of feel like we was part of that whole culture of changing jazz to playing backbeats and putting funk beats to, like, you know, jazz. And so also, like, was hella influenced by Will Kennedy also, because he did do that. So a lot of this stuff, like a lot of my approach on the Christian Scott stuff is a lot like Will Kennedy approach to Yellow Jackets, in my opinion. because I was super like listening to him a lot. And so, like, so for me, it's like I thought we were gonna win then, because it wasn't no other people coming out. It wasn't no Robert Glasper's or none of them. Right. They weren't doing that thing.
Yeah.
So I thought we were gonna win. We did not win. So then when after I was in the Mars Volta and we did that record and the record came out, I remember the first night we listened to it, I was at a pizza spot listening to the shit in a car, and I was like, this is insane. And I couldn't listen through the whole record.
Right.
Because it was just too much. And then we got nominated. Like, we started touring more and it was crazy. And then we got nominated for a Grammy, and they did not want to go. They were like, we not going to that. We don't care about that shit. And they were, you know, the thing that I did like about them is they treated everything on some punk rock shit.
Uh-huh.
And I understood that. But I also, you know, I worked with Keisha Cole real close when she first got her deal.
Right.
And so I understood that you got to still play the game. So, like, I respected what they were saying, but I was like, dude, if we nominated, we'd have a pretty good chance of winning this motherfucker.
Right.
And it was Motley Crue, Jethro Tull, us, and somebody else. Like, it had to be like some other hair metal band. And I'm like, we probably gonna win this shit.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we won. You know what I mean?
Look at that. Come on, you better speak just, it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I mean, it's just like sometimes you just don't win when you know you should win.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you, like, that was an undeniable thing right there. Like, the Christian Scott thing was like, it was undeniable too, but he was such a young artist. Like, the Mars Volta, man, they had a little bit of press behind him. They were like, they were doing well. So to have a big record come out of nowhere with a new drummer, it was almost like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm. I can understand that. And it's crazy because I remember, bro, no lie, when you were playing that stuff, I didn't know of them before you, of course, but when you were playing that music, it made me see two things. It made me see your versatility, one, and it made me also see how, you know, just being 1,000 right now, like how the blacks, how we bring the real soul even to rock, because if we're going to be real, we were the first to start the rock. But at the same time, it's like the fact that you remained you and you bought all of that you acquired over the years and decades, like musically, you know what I'm saying? Like that's what that Grammy was. If you ask me, bro, like you deserve that. You know what I'm saying? And you knew it.
The thing that I loved about what they did for me is like, they allow me, like sometimes, bro, you be playing with people who like they have to like physically fight. They have to physically, emotionally, and every other way you can fucking fight for fucking attention.
Yeah.
So they just was like, play. You know what I mean? Almost how, like, that's what I used to love about John P. Key, man. He just lets the drummer play, yo.
Right.
He just like, he be like, play, bro, you know?
Yeah.
And they just let me play. And even it was times I didn't want to play like that, and it was like, play. And so, like, for me, it was like, you know, I always approach, especially records, I approach records from the place of like, let's do some shit that people aren't doing.
Yeah.
Like, if I go and go do, if I'm going in the studio for a whole week to do a record with somebody, maybe I should bring this weird ass tom or this weird snare or this weird cymbal or something that's going to make this thing have a sound, or maybe I need to change my drum setup a little bit or make it uncomfortable for myself.
Or maybe
set up the full fucking drum set. You know what I mean? Like the full shit that you set up when you at your house. Like,
just
switch it up a little bit and maybe it'll add some kind of spice. You know, some kind of like...
Mm-hmm.
So...
That's real.
When I came into the situation, I also understood that, like, the rock records at the time that was coming out, the drummers wasn't playing no fucking fills.
Right.
They was playing straight. And even if they was playing a bunch of metal bass drum shit, they wouldn't play any fills in the middle of it. It would, you know, it'd be super straight.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So my mind is like, if I can go play, if I can have the sound that, you know, when a lot of people, when they think of music or they think of, you know, even like a fucking somebody who hires musicians, they'll go and they'll be like, I want a band. And then when they get the band, they'll be like, the band is too loud. So it's
so
like,
real.
Yep. It's like people have their idea of what they want some shit to sound like, mm-hmm. but it's like almost like a fake, it's almost like a fake ass thought. So I know when people hear rock drums, they go, they, their mind goes to like three people. It goes to like John Bonham. Mm-hmm. It goes to like Black Sabbath, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It might go into like Mitch Mitchell, you know, a little bit of, you know, Keith Moon. Like, it goes to these okay. certain people that their mind is like, man, when I listen to, when I think of gospel drumming, I think of, you know, you got the weirdos who don't know much who be like, I think of Gospel Chops video, you know what I mean?
Right.
But then so I know these guys are thinking of these certain drummers. So I'm trying to like channel the sound that maybe a Mitch Mitchell is getting or Buddy Miles or John Bonham. But I'm also trying to like, how do I play my shit and still have this sound?
Yeah, exactly. Incorporate, you know, your shit into that shit. Right.
So when I first got the gig, they wanted me to play a 14-inch fucking tom and a 16-inch floor tom, 24-inch bass drum. And I was like, bro, I'm not going to be able to play my shit the way I want to play my shit on that kit.
Mm-hmm.
It was a Ludwig stainless steel kit.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had to figure out a way to even incorporate my shit into this idea of what they think they want these drums to sound like. They want them to sound like John Bonham. So I'm like, how do I make DWs look like a vintage kit and sound like John Bonham and me be able to play my shit?
Right. That's a lot of processing going on.
That's why you start seeing me play 24-inch crashes, 19-inch hi-hats, 24-inch rides, because that's what they're playing.
Yeah, that's real. You can't get that.
John Bonham had a 26-inch bass drum.
Right.
Exactly. So it's like, how do I come in this situation and play my shit but have this sound that they think they fucking hear?
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
So it was like a lot of mixture of that, and somehow that shit just turned out magical.
Mm-hmm. That's crazy, bro. That, like, on some real too, the fact that you said that, you know, switching up the kit and, you know, putting yourself in that uncomfortable position, a lot of people are scared to do that shit because, you know, people, I get it, like, you know, we human, and I understand you fear you might mess up or something, or you might not please the artist or MD, but it's like, that's, I always tell people, like, yo, they called you. You know what I'm saying? Like, they called you for a reason. Like, they called you because you dope. So you got to learn how to even be still, you know, yourself and be dope in another element. You know what I'm saying? Like, and I think that's a great point, bro, because a lot of people have been asking me that on the low. Like, yo, man, how do I approach this gig and blah, blah, blah. And I'd be like, honestly, I mean, you know what I'm saying? Do you. But I mean, if you got to put yourself in that uncomfortable position, guess what? You're going to grow. Or actually, it's going to show you, you know, if you're strong enough to keep going. Because if you know what I'm saying? If you bitch out, if you bitch up on it because it's something new and different, then you're not ready to be out here.
And it has something to do with also, like, you knowing the artist. Like, you know, like,
mm-hmm.
sometimes, like, we would sit backstage and I would just let them just teach me about music. I would just let them play me shit. I'd be like, what is that? They'd be like, that's the Bad Brains. I'm like, what is that? That's this. So they were showing me music that I never heard. And like, I also, I'm like that guy who is like, when I see people, when I meet people out of the country or people anywhere, and I hang out with them for any kind of time and I appreciate them, mm-hmm. I'll be like, I'll give them my iPhone and I'll be like, write all the artists that you like.
That's dope. That's really dope.
So then, yeah. Like, so then you like, you know, you kind of have an idea the kind of music your partner listen to.
Because
mm-hmm. it's kind of hard to map out and be yourself in a situation where you don't even know what people want. And that was a lot of the problem with the Mars Volta for me, is I didn't know what band I was in. I didn't know shit. Mm-hmm. So like the first few months, people were on the blogs killing me. Oh, he didn't play this like John Theodore.
Wow.
Blah, 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 blah. And then even now, I do gigs and motherfuckers give me like the smallest amount of rehearsal time, and they'd be like, bro, you don't know all the songs. And so it's like, like, luck, they were patient with me.
Right.
You know, they were patient with me enough for me to get the shit together and figure out, you know, some correct small shit. Like, it would be, like, small. Oh, man, he hit it on the crash. He didn't hit it on the snare like the album. It's like little shit that they would be nitpicking on, but mostly on the internet.
Yeah, of course the internet.
And then after, like, you know, you kind of need to know and be comfortable and know what people want, you know? And I think a lot of times, like, for me, I never treated them like they were separate from me. You know what I mean? I have a hard time playing with artists that I feel like I have to separate myself from them. Like, if I watch people who, you know, I just watched a video where, you know, I hate to say it, but R. Kelly, where somebody was like, yeah, you couldn't talk to the dancers.
Yep.
So if you can't talk to the dancers, you definitely can't talk to R. Kelly.
Right.
So it's like, I can't do a gig like that, because to me, it's like, who is anybody where I can't talk to them? It's
right.
Like, what the fuck? Like, you know? So to me, I choose not to do that kind of work. You know what I mean? Like, it just doesn't make... And a lot of times, since I have chosen not to do it, it just, people don't hit me up to do that type of shit. So I had never been in a situation where I couldn't at least talk to any. I don't treat them as like they're not me. I treat them as, like, when people say the artist is the band also. So it's like, I don't know. It's just a weird type of thought pattern. So it never was like that. So I would always be asking them to share with me, and I'd be trying to share. Be like, listen to this shit. Listen to this. You man, it's countless times I've been on a gig with a singer who had no traction in the church, and I would show them a singer from the church.
And they've
been countless times.
Yup.
You know what I mean?
That's real.
So I try to share with people music, and that's more helpful to know what they like. But sometimes that's the problem. You just don't even really know what they into.
Mm-hmm. That's true, bro. That's very true. Or like going off somebody else's like, or somebody else's acceptance of a song or whatever, or artist or whatever. Like, people really don't know what they like. That's real.
Yeah.
That's true. And so all right. So now it's funny you say that, because this is a great segue into this next section. But like, the industry of today, as far as like, you know, the drumming world, and like how artists are treating musicians, and how management are treating musicians, and MDs are treating musicians, like companies, how companies are treating musicians. Like, I had a talk with a few friends, and we had issues about this, as far as like a lot of people that are being acknowledged, and no offense to them, whatever, do your thing, but at the same time, those people aren't really working as much as we are, and you know, like, they're getting the videos, they're getting all of the whatever you want to call it, you know what I'm saying, from the company, but we get some free stuff, you know, and maybe a clinic, you know what I'm saying, but we don't really get the love that we think we should all get. Like, what do you really think about that, bro? Because a lot of us talk about that amongst each other.
I think a lot of it has to do with your relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, sometimes some people offer a service that they can't do themselves. Like, I know some YouTubers that had like a million views, like a million hit, like a million subscribers, bro.
Mm-hmm.
But these people cannot play.
Yeah.
Like, if you sat next to them, they would be like, no, I can't play like you.
Yep.
But they getting treated at the companies exactly like you. You'd be like, this is confusing. So what's going on is that some people, like these companies are so, like, new to social media.
Yeah.
That they sometimes have been known to, you know, basically give these YouTubers that are not good treatment that they don't necessarily... Well, I wouldn't say they don't deserve it. I would just say that in the past would not have been as seen as valuable.
There you go. That's
what I mean. So
yeah.
Now it's like, you know, they value the guy with a million thousand subscribers, because these companies want to figure out how they can get that many subscribers.
Mm-hmm.
So,
exactly.
And then so it in return, it starts to be like, what is your worth to the company?
Mm-hmm.
Like, how worth it is it to to have this dude who, yes, he's on every gig, but that might mean he's worth more. He's worth a lot to the artist.
Yeah.
But how is he worth anything to the drum company if that guy is sitting behind a big ass screen playing with the gorillas? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's like, nigga, they can't see you.
Exactly.
So no matter how many fans is coming to the gig, you're not really worth it to a drum company, because not only don't they see a logo, but you got a gorilla drum head in the front with hella garbage, whatever they got on the stage, where you can't see shit. You know what I mean? Then the company is like, yeah, you play with that big ass band, but like no one sees you.
Right.
First, a guy who has, you know, has a, you know, maybe plays in a regular band that isn't that huge, but they can do, you know, club cities and do it well. They can do New Orleans jazz. Mm-hmm. They could do all the festival circuits. They could do the whole hippie circuit.
Right.
And, you know, on average, they got 500 people at their show, 400 people at their show. But they get to see the drummer take a solo for 3 hours.
Exactly.
It helps them to sell their product, and he deems to be more valuable as an endorsement asset than this guy who is playing in front of millions of people
who can't,
no one can
who's
see
not
him.
Seen. Yeah, exactly.
So
that makes sense.
It's a push. It's a give and take, because, you know, you don't want to give up things that are valuable and prideful about yourself. Like, you don't want to be fucking selling out, but at the same time, if you want these people to do things for you, it's like this balance of like give and take, and a giving, and how much you want to bend and how much you don't want to bend.
Mm-hmm.
But
that's,
I don't know, that's what I see more than anything, and I see a lot of nepotism. You know, you never know where people's relationship lies. You never know how long people have known each other, where they know each other from.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's a lot. It's a lot that goes into it.
Mm-hmm. It's a whole lot, man. It's actually great you said that, because I'm like, it made me kind of think as well, because me and my big brother Brian Moore, of course you know Brian, but we talked about like, you know, the same situation as far as like, you know, how the companies kind of respect other people and disrespect other people. Well, not more so disrespect, but like don't show the respect that they kind of deserve. You know what I'm saying? And I think that you really just made a good point as far as like understanding, you know, like being a drummer, or, you know, playing for artists behind, you know, a curtain or in the pit or whatever. Like, yeah, you definitely not really an asset to the company if we can't see you, but they can only see you on Instagram. You know what I'm saying? Like posting it before the show or after. It's like nobody really, you know, that's kind of old now. You know what I'm saying? So it's like,
yeah.
Go, what'd you say?
I mean, unless you can like figure out a way, like for me, like it's been, you know, it's like right now, Eric Moore has figured out a way to make himself be both.
Mm-hmm.
Like he can, like Arrows is a good gig because, yeah, she could be in the front, but it's not all in the front. You know what I mean? So what he does is he does videos to counteract the fact that he is still also playing behind somebody, and then it gives him content, which is genius too. There's multiple ways to do it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just how much do you want to give?
Yeah,
like for me,
yeah.
It's like, you know, for me, it's like I've always grown up in like a punk rock point of view. Like I've never, like the moment I went to church and I dyed my hair blonde and dude would let me play, I was over it. I was like, so people can come as they are. We got dudes dressed like women.
Right.
We got dudes with purses and fucking nails and they toes out of shit. Niggas with fucking they got finger waves.
Right.
Niggas
exactly.
With makeup on, hella fucking makeup on and shit. And I'm wrong for dyeing my hair and you won't let me play the drums, but these niggas is creeps. I was over it.
Yep, yep.
I was over it.
That's
and so
right.
It's like, for me, it's like I've always come from a punk rock point of view, so I've always been like, you know, everything I do matters. So I don't, there's certain things I won't do. Like I won't set up my camera every night to play the drums, to show it, because to me that action is weird. Like the action is play the drums, turn into a videographer,
mm-hmm.
Edit that shit, link the music up, put a title, caption it, post it on the Instagram, and at that moment, I don't even remember what I did it for anymore, because it wasn't for nothing real. It was like,
yeah.
I'm doing some, I'm a do. This is what I do. I don't have to like all the time. It's like when somebody like take care of their kid on camera every time. It's like, bro, like if you're a parent and you love your kid, you it's gonna be times where. Is it ever gonna be a time where the camera ain't on, bro? Right. Like to me, it's like weird.
That's real.
So I won't ever do that. You know what I mean? But mm-hmm. like some people, that's how they are, and a lot of the companies. They need that kind of, they need, that's free advertisement for them.
Exactly.
They don't got to do nothing, bro. They don't got to set up one light. They don't mm-hmm. they don't got to pay for not one mix job. They don't got to pay for nothing. You know what I mean? You just gave them a video to fucking promote for mm-hmm. free.
That's real.
And so for me, you know, just because I have a good relationship with them, you know, I can pick and choose what things I get on. You know what I mean? So I don't have to look lame
mm-hmm.
or look like outside of myself.
Yeah.
But, I mean, some people, that's just how they get down. I just don't get down like that. So for me, it's weird. You know what I mean? So mm-hmm. I think it's all about picking and choosing how to make yourself marketable without losing your fucking integrity.
Wow. That's big right there. Bing! That's big right there, bro.
Because some people will just give it up, bro. They don't care. And like, it makes it hard because you're like, damn, am I supposed to do it like that?
Yeah.
And then you're like, maybe it's to a degree. Maybe you could do more. You know what I mean? Maybe do more of this, a little less of that. Maybe less of this, more of that. But for me, I just try to like, you know, try to walk a fine line at how much cornball let me set up my camera before I do the gig type shit. You know what I mean? Because it starts to get weird.
This cornball setup.
Yeah, I mean, it just gets weird because there's so many actions. You know, it's like, you know, when I was young, I would do that, but I wasn't doing that to promote myself. I was doing that shit to see what I sound like.
That's so real. That's so crazy, bro. Yup. Listen to yourself.
These dudes is doing it for clout.
Yeah.
And then you be like, so you doing that for clout. And they be like, what do you mean clout? I'm like, what do I mean clout?
Right. What do I mean? What's the other reason
you film yourself all day? Like, and then post it. Like, if you filmed it, these dudes is editing it. You know what I mean? They using one video shoot for like, they spread it out for months.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I don't know. I'm just the punk rock in me, you know, now I'm starting to get to a point where I'm not as punk rock as I was, but
mm-hmm.
the punk rock in me ain't gonna allow me to do that every time. Maybe a couple times, but not every single time I set my drums up.
Yeah. Yeah. I understand that. That's real. Cause it does take you out your element though, man. Like, I can't hold you. Like, when you want to play drums, you want to play drums. You know what I mean? Like, when you know it's a gig tonight, you thinking about playing the damn drums. You're not worried. You shouldn't be worried about, oh man, let me set this 3D camera up, or this 360 camera and this GoPro over here. Like, it's, I don't know. It just became a thing where now everybody has their own TV show. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, it's cool, but at the same time, like you said, like, if that's what you want to do, you know what I'm saying?
It was different. It was different because we all didn't get to see our progress all the time.
Exactly.
Like, I remember, like, you know, Ronald Brunner would come to town, and I couldn't wait to watch his full play because I knew he was going to do some new shit.
Exactly.
I'm like, I want to see what this fool about to do.
Exactly.
Right? And then, so, like, it was a time where, you know, we would film each other. We would film ourselves, but I wasn't like, Ronald, let me show you this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, pre-internet, I wasn't like, Ronald, let me show you this new film. Like, I would, but not like my whole practice routine. But like these dudes got long minutes of videos.
Yeah, it's so a whole like, minute of, yeah.
So it's like, no, I mean hours of videos, bro. I'm being generous.
Oh, man.
But like, so it's like, so for me, it wasn't like I'm trying to hide what I was playing,
mm-hmm.
but I wasn't trying to give it up. Like, we had, you know, the drum off. We had drum competitions, you know what I mean?
Right.
So niggas wasn't trying to show everything you could play because you want people to come to the show. You wanna have something at GMWA that was sick that people ain't seen before. You don't just give it out on the internet.
Right.
But now everybody gives it out. And me saying how we didn't give it out makes me sound like an old head.
Right.
Because
old bitter nigga.
Yeah, but it's just like, I mean, to me, it's real, bro. And so, like, now it's like this whole element of surprise, this whole element of, like, what is this dude going to do? Like, it just is over, man. You see these kids and you wait for them to play the field that you've seen on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
You'd be like, let's get it. Yeah. You know, and I think it just, like, you know, it wears, like, I remember people in L.A., you know, it was a thing that I used to come up with that was called wearing out your newness.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you come into L.A. and you be super new and no one knows you. And then after a while, everyone knows you and people are like, oh, what's up, bruh?
Right, right, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
It's not the same as the first time they saw you. And so it's like, to me, it's really difficult because it's like, who, you know, the only drummers that I'm excited about is like 6 and 7.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody else got 1,000 videos and you know how they play.
Yeah.
So it's,
that's
so
what
I don't know. I think it just took a little bit of the, like, the excitement out of it. Like, mm-hmm. The excitement of seeing a show. Like, I don't know, man. You can watch everybody's show on the internet. I remember we could not watch a Mick Addition show. You have to go there and you'd be tripping out. You'd be like, what the hell? Or
exactly.
Or Vinny Caliuta. You know, you have to go see him.
Mm-hmm.
And when you saw him, like, I don't know, some of these people, when you see them, it's so much better than a video, but they give you too much video.
Yeah.
You already know what to expect. You know what the drums is going to look like.
And sound like, all that. Yep.
Sound like, that's, you real. Know who the tech is.
Right.
You know who the photographer is.
Right. You know whole thing.
You know too much. Yeah, yeah, you know too much. You know who the whole band is, like, months before people ever go on tour.
Yeah.
And I remember not knowing that. You'd be like, who is that? You know?
Mm-hmm. But now you can easily look, you can easily find it.
Yeah, now it's a new day and age, man. And I don't know. Like, I'm just going to continue to be myself. Like, if everybody want to do that, they could do that. You know what I mean? I'm going to continue to do what I do.
Mm-hmm. But, I mean, that's how you've been winning, bro. Being you.
Yeah.
Like, real talk. Like, that's, you know what I mean? Like, a lot of people say that we, you know, like, we're similar when it comes to, like, being verbal and expressive. And that's because I think they don't understand that we're passionate about music. You know what I'm saying? Like, this ain't no, like, oh, we just want to play drums and make some money type shit. This is like, no, we started as babies. You know what I'm saying? Like, children.
Yeah.
And we, you know, grew into, like, literally and physically loving music. And so when we talk about it, that's why you looked at as the old head or the, you know what I'm saying? Like, the old head that's saying something. And people said that same to me. And I was like, yeah. Yo, listen, say what you want to say. The reality is, I'm here working. Like, God has blessed me to work. So apparently, like, I'm telling y'all these things because I know what can, you know, basically what can keep you working, or it don't matter what changes in the industry. If you still abide by these rules musically, you're always going to work. But
yeah, my main thing is I just don't want to, like, I don't ever want to go out as you. I know it's never going to happen anyway, but I just never want you to be like, damn, this fool ain't here no more. Remember when he did that cornball last year, like, play with Britney Spears? And he'd be like, I just don't. Or you remember when that fool did this cornball ass gig on TV, and you go put all this dope shit, and then you got me on TV just looking ridiculous. Like,
mm-hmm.
I be watching niggas on, I'm sorry to say that word, but I be watching people, up there dancing with your favorite artist and never playing one note. That I know that is amazing musicians. I'm like, bro, you up there dancing with my favorite artist, bro, but you're not even playing one note on TV.
Mm-hmm.
It's just an L. It's just an L for the, like, the like, for me, because it's like, I look at it like, bro, like, all fame and all money, bro. That shit, man, sometimes you look stupid for it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Sometimes you got to look real stupid for the money, and I don't want you to be able to pull that up on YouTube. So I just... That's why I really try to maintain myself, so people later on would be like, that fool held himself with some dignity. The same dignity that Prince had, the same dignity that Jimmy had.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you never seen Jimi Hendrix up there playing with no corny artists. Like, I mean,
right.
You just never saw it, bro. And, like, we see people who are of that caliber, people who are amazing musicians up there with people who they have no business. Those people shouldn't even be able to be around them, bro.
Yeah.
As a musician. Them fools ain't even musicians.
That's the thing. They're not even musicians.
And you up there with them and you kind of like co-signing them.
Being good corny.
I don't know. And so for me, it's like, that's where I've always been. I just try to maintain my, trying to play with dope people. You know what I mean? Like, I'm proud of the people I play with. Yeah. Like, I think, like, a lot of people that I work with is some, like, the sickest of the sickest. And I respect them. I would respect them if I never played drums.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So,
that's just the rule of the music, the musicality they have. Like, it has to be respected. That's dope, bro. I'm really excited to hear that. You know, like, you really have done all this in your career, man. Like, you understand, bro. Like, I know you, but this is crazy because I'm getting to know you more. It's like, damn, this is how he really thinks. This is like my brother. Like, so this is good for me. I'm telling you, this is good for me. But if you don't mind, bro, please tell the people where they can find you. As far as the social media and all that stuff, whatever it is,
man. Right now I'm on. I have a website. My website is thomaspridgeon.com. Mm-hmm. Right now I'm getting it together. It's up and running and functional, but we're still updating it. It's kind of like a coming soon under construction site, but I still got a store on there.
Okay.
Where you can buy a bunch of clothes. And
that's
I'm
dope.
About
I'm getting
to
something.
Work with
I'm getting something, bro.
I'm about to work with distributing like certain drum items that I like that they don't sell in the store because I'm tired. Like, what happens is Guitar Center owns such a big market in America that they almost make the companies, end result make whatever they want. So since all the drums that they sell, like Guitar Center's drum set that sells the most is the Questlove drum set. And Ludwig pretty much doesn't make any money off it. It's like a $500 kit. It costs almost $500 to make it. They make no money off it, but it's the highest selling kit. And the next ones that start going up start being like $800, $1,200, and then like the guys who can play, you know, have a decent amount of playing, they'll go from $1,400 to $1,800. So the market of kits that I usually like to play are a little bit higher in price. And it makes all these items that are high-end items also get pushed down and they don't buy them. So, like, it's a lot of things I play from companies like Stack Percussion, like shakers and rings, things that mount to the cymbals and snare. The snare muffles that you see from BDF, those guys, the Ballman percussion little stack thing, the clap stack. Like these items that we are kind of making hot, I want to be able to sell them on my site without like having to go through these companies. Like real talk, because it's other stuff like the DW pedal. I got a pedal plate that has no writing on it. It's just buffed out. And so that stuff I want to start selling. So I'm about to start selling some drum related gear. I also want to sell some drumsticks from some of the artists that we mess with that you cannot find in the stores. I know Tony Royster got a stick. I ain't never seen it in a store. I know Aaron Spears now has a stick. Who else got a stick? A lot of people got a stick.
Yeah.
But we never see them in the stores. We just see them online. You know, we see a little font online and you go to the store. You're like, you got the Teddy Campbell? They'd be like, what?
Right.
So I want to sell those sticks online, or like, you know, bass drum beaters. I remember Rick Latham had a bass drum beater that was crystal. And I wanted to sell these kind of items online. And so my website is developing. It's about to be sick. And I'm also on Facebook, on Instagram, sorry. Instagram is Badass Thomas Pridgeon. And then I'm on Twitter, kind of. And so I'm on all that shit, bro. I'm on YouTube. But
I ain't been on Twitter in a minute. Damn.
Yeah, Twitter is just a place where you go just to say nonsense.
Yeah, yep. That's why
it's
I can't
just
be
nonsense
on there.
I wanna. I wish I could. I wish, dude. In a perfect world, dude, I wouldn't be on any of that shit.
Right. In a perfect world, right? Ain't that crazy? Wish you could be on there. That's so real, bro.
It's like one of those things, man. When I was in the Mars Volta, I did not have it, and people used to be like, "Bro, you don't have a Facebook," and then this guy actually made my Instagram. I mean, he made my Facebook, And I ended up writing him. I was like, who are you? And he was like, I'm from Australia. I'm a fan. I just thought you should have it. And he gave me my favorite.
That's really dope. That's crazy, but that's still dope.
But I wish he didn't, bro. He gave me the worst thing in life.
Yep. He put you on. He put you a part of the Facebook matrix.
Right. I was doing so good.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
But y'all have to make sure you follow my brother, man. Please follow him, because he always has something to say on his posts. He always has something positive, and he always has some real shit. And he also always has something musically on his posts. And I think y'all like should really check him out, because he's a realist just like I am. And he's got music coming out. It's always gonna be something coming from him. You know what I'm saying? So check out the website, follow him, and say what's up to him, because he does respond. He's not corny. You know what I'm saying? So don't be scared to say what's up to him. But Thomas, man, I love you, bro. Seriously, man. Thank you for this. I guess next time I see you, I guess we'll put one up in the air, brother.
All right, bro.
You already know what that's about. But yo, everybody, have a great day. Have a great week. We love you. Peace.
Peace.
Okay, that's the end of my slave song.
Come up and listen to it.
Boots Green Podcast. Real talk. Real talk.